Cell membranes contain various proteins. Among them, transmembrane proteins are those that span the cell membrane entirely. So they have an extracellular, a transmembrane, and an intracellular region. So, for example, here, these are. This is a transmembrane protein. This is one, and this is one. And this is, for example, so this is a peripheral protein, and this is a surface protein. So we are talking about these. And transmembrane proteins play an important role in many cellular processes, as they, for example, moving ions or molecule, other molecules through the membrane. And they are commonly associated with various diseases, human diseases. Therefore, they are significant drug targets. To develop new therapies targeting them, we need to understand how they work. For this, structure determination of transmembrane proteins is important, as these solved structures can be used to used for further computational studies. Knowing their transmembrane regions is also crucial to understand their working mechanism. Yet experimental data on the membrane embedment is sparse. There are experiments where tags are inserted at various positions around putative transmembrane helixes, but these provide low-resolution data. The lack of sufficient experimental data on membrane embedment led to the development of in silico membrane prediction methods. Here are the visual outputs of the most popular ones. TMDAT and PPM define the membrane as a slab with two parallel planes, while MemproTMD builds a bilayer around the protein using molecular dynamics simulations. However, the experimental data used as reference during their development was, as I mentioned before, low resolution. Cryo-electron microscopy is an increasingly popular and advanced method for structure determination. It led to an increasing number of solved transmembrane protein structures in the presence of a lipid environment. In the resulting EMD map, we can see the membrane environment as a blob around the protein. We figured that if we could calculate the boundaries of this membrane environment, we could provide high-resolution experimental data on the transmembrane regions. Therefore, we built a pipeline to extract this membrane blob and to convert it to transmembrane regions. In the next 10 minutes, I will show you how it works. Our inputs are an EMD map and the corresponding structural model of the protein. From the model, from the structure, we generate a theoretical density map of the protein, which we subtract from the EMD map. This way, we simplify our further calculations, as now our map contains only the densities of the blob, at least in an ideal case. Here you can see that there are some extra blobs. These are those parts of the original EMD map, which weren't used to create this model. For example, because they are ligands or disordered regions. We need to eliminate these from our further calculations. To make this simple, we translate our coordinates by a matrix from TMDAT, which sets the origin into the middle of the predicted bilayer. This way, we make sure that our origin is inside the membrane blob. We use the TMDAT because we think it's a great membrane predictor and we could easily integrate it to our pipeline, but we could use other membrane predictors as well. Previously, we investigated the differences between their predictions, between their predictions on the membrane positions along the z-axis. We compared the values from TMDAT, MemprotMD, and our coarse grain simulations to the values from PPM. Here you can see some of the examples of our results, showing the ones with the biggest differences. We found that in most cases, these methods produce similar results on the membrane position. Now that we have the membrane blob, we can convert it to transmembrane regions. To do this, we want to make a two-dimensional projection of this membrane blob. First, we generate the XY sections of the blob along the z-axis. Then we cut these sections into angle slices like a cake and sum the density values in each slice. This way, we get an array of density value for every z-angle pair. This array was smoothed and presented in two dimensions. Now we want to search the first minimum density values from our origin for both positive and negative z directions. We identify the membrane blob's boundaries as these minimum, as these first minimum values. We project them to the whole atom structure to pair the atoms with their localizations. Surface atoms that are beyond the determined boundaries are in the water phase. Atoms, so there is an interface region which is usually 8 to 10 angstrom thick. And atoms that are closer to the center than this are in the hydrophobic core. We built a web server from this pipeline where you can submit your protein's EMD map and all atom structure to get its membrane blob and transmembrane regions. We've already run it for 92 transmembrane protein structures, which were determined by CREO-EM with a resolution of 4 angstroms or better. Approximately 30% of the maps don't exhibit well-defined densities for the membrane environment. These structures have either been solved in the absence of a well-formed lipid environment, or this lipid environment was masked out before uploading the map to the database. In some cases, the EMD maps have a very low signal-to-noise ratio, which prevents the detection of the membrane boundaries. Here are two structures of the same protein to show an example for the missing membrane blob. This structure was solved in a membrane environment called NICEL, and this was solved in amphipole, and you can see that this one doesn't have any densities around it. But we investigated that if there are any correlation between the visibility of the membrane environment and the type of it, and we didn't find any. We also made a comparison between TMDAT predictions and our memlob results. First, we had to convert our boundaries, which follows the shape of the lipid environment, to parallel slabs. So we averaged the z-coordinates of the boundaries for each of the sides. To get the thickness of the hydrophobic core, we calculated the distance between our new parallel slabs, and we decreased it by the two interface, by the thickness of the two interface regions. This way, we get the thickness of the hydrophobic core. The membrane center of the memlob slab differs from the TMDAT center by more than 5 angstroms, only in 4 cases. However, plotting the distribution of the bilayer thickness calculated by Membloben TMDAT, we can see that our Membloben pipeline in many cases determines a thicker membrane environment than TMDAT. This thicker membrane environment is often caused by the deep embedment of the protein into the lipids. So short regions that predicted to be extracellular are indicated intramembranous by our membrane, our pipeline. We investigated if this deeper embedment depends on the type of the membrane mimetics. We found that nanodisc produce mostly similar membrane thickness than the TMDAT predictions. While this is true for only half of the structures solved in Amphipole, approximately 60% of the structures solved in MICEL have a thicker membrane environment than was predicted before. Though we need to investigate more structures to tell for sure, we can assume that the type of the membrane mimetics has an impact of the thickness of the resulted membrane blob, and therefore the calculated transmembrane regions. I demonstrated here that density maps contain valuable information other than the well-formed calculated protein structure. We built a pipeline to extract the membrane position of transmembrane proteins from electron density maps. This is the first method ever which is suitable to provide high-resolution experimental data on the membrane boundaries. I would like to thank my colleagues, our collaborators, and funding agencies. I also thank the chair for the opportunity to show you our Membloben tool. Thank you.
So, any questions from the audience?
So, how long is the execution of the pipeline? How much do you have to wait for the results?
But it depends on the size of the whole structure, but it's about one minute.
Any other questions? I would have one also. Could you go back to, it was I think one of the first slides that showed the different kind of models which showed the model of the membranes. This one, yes. That these models look that their computational complexity is totally not on the same line. And the Memblob, how does it compare to these methods?
Memblob is... So these methods both predict the membrane position. Why Memblob is not a prediction method. It's calculate, so it work with actual experimental data and
extracts the membrane.
And extracts this membrane blob.
Yes.
So, okay. Was your question?
Yes, okay. I slightly misunderstood. Yes, okay. Any other questions? If no, then let's thank our speaker again.
Thank you.